Good afternoon, good evening, everyone. Folks, are you ready to study the Bible? Does someone here, some tired, no? Everyone here is ready? Okay, so let's begin with word of prayer.
Our gracious Father in heaven, we kneel before you in humility to ask you to give us again your Holy Spirit, that we may learn and that we may understand what you want to tell us tonight. We thank you in the name of Jesus. Amen. Amen.
After you finish, announce that we're having special music at that time, and then I'll take over and close the service, okay?
Okay. The title of this presentation is, as I was announced, is the third angel's message. Because my first presentation was on the first, my second on the second, and also on the fourth, because they are connected, and my last presentation is on the third angel's message. So let's consider, what is the message of the third angel? And I invite you to open your Bible with me, and let's consider it in Revelation chapter 14. Revelation chapter 14, verse 9 to 12. Revelation chapter 14, verse 9 to 12. And I know that we have already read these verses today, but let's read them again. Revelation chapter 14, verse 9 to 12. And the third angel followed them, saying with a loud voice, "If any man worship the beast and his image, and receive his mark in his forehead or in his hand, the same shall drink of the wine of the wrath of God, which is poured out without mixture into the cup of his indignation, and he shall be tormented with fire and brimstone in the presence of the holy angels and in the presence of the Lamb. And the smoke of their torment ascendeth up for ever and ever, and they have no rest day nor night, who worship the beast and his image, and whosoever receiveth the mark of his name." Here is the patience of the saints. Here are they that keep the commandment of God and the faith of Jesus. The first angel gave his message. Then followed the second angel. And after the second angel followed the third angel. If we do not accept the message of the first angel, we'll not be able to accept the message of the second angel. And consequently, we'll not be able to accept the message of the third angel, but also of the fourth angel. I said this because when we have a problem with the fourth angel message, friends, it's because we have a problem with one of the three messages. And maybe with all of them. This is a point that I wanted to make. But I want to make a second point before starting the study. We have one angel followed by a second angel, and himself followed by a third angel. Do you think that their message are not in agreement? No. Their messages are in agreement. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Friends, here we have a camp meeting in the Bible. Revelation 14, verse 6 to 12. It's a camp meeting. And you have a preacher. The first preacher arrived and he gave his message. The second preacher followed him and he gave his message. And the third preacher followed him and gave his message. And we are okay that these three messages are in agreement. I want now to have a word for the leaders of our movement. When God organized a camp meeting in the Bible, friends, all the messengers are in agreement. That's very, very important, friends. Because if one of these messengers in the Bible was not in agreement with the two previous ones, the earth, the inhabitant of the earth, will be in confusion. And for myself, I don't want to see any one of you in confusion. That's why, as preacher, as leader, pastor, call them as you want. We cannot. God is not, and I'm sure of that because we can see it in the Bible. We cannot please to God when we came in the same camp meeting with preachers who are not standing on the platform of the eternal truth. This is the second point. But now, let us enter in our study. Let it be clear that the verse 12 of the 14th chapter of Revelation is among the message given by the third angel. And I start with that point because in my country, people start to teach. Some people have started to teach that verse 12, here is the patience of the saints. Here are they that keep the commandment of God and the faith of Jesus. People from, I don't know from which, but they came and they started to say that verse 12 is not among the message of the third angel. No, because the word, my friend, the words contained in that verse are not introduced by the voice from heaven that we can read in verse 13. Do you catch this? Did you catch this? And I heard a voice. So that is a landmark for us to know that it is a transition for another thing. But people are teaching that, you know, the verse 12 is not among the third angel message. And you will understand why it is important to have this understanding in a few moments. In the first part of our study, we have studied the longest prophetic period that we find in the Bible. Which one? 2,300 days. Okay. And we have established that the proclamation of the third angel's message must start under here, that this proclamation must start on the 22nd of October 1844. The fourth angel, who repeat and amplify the message of the second, comes after the third. However, after the proclamation of the third angel's message, we see the coming of Jesus for the reaping of the harvest of the earth in verse 15, which is according to the word of Jesus in Matthew 13, verse 39, what? The end of the world, my friend. In other words, the second coming of Christ brings with it the end of the world. And consequently, the third angel's message is for this world, the last message of mercy to which the fourth angel's message united his voice and gives his power. Keep that in mind, friends. The first angel requires the true worship. And I insisted in my first presentation upon the judgment, but it is obvious, friends, that he requires the true worship. And one of his purpose is to lead us to know the truth about God. All right? So the first angel requires the true worship, while the third angel presents the true worship. And I invite you to have your Bible, to stay with your Bible open in Revelation 14, and try to catch what I am saying to you, and to read it in your Bible. Don't just listen to me, but try to verify if what I am saying is true. The first angel required the true worship, while the third angel presents the true worship in contrast with the false one. And according to the third angel, friends, the true worship is based on what? The commandments of God and the faith of Jesus. Amen, my sister. While the false worship is based on which entities? The beast and his image. These entities. And they bring some things, which is, the mark of the beast, right? And I want you to keep that in mind throughout our study of this message. Because if we are not able, my friend, to identify the beast, or if we have a misconception of the identity of the beast, what's going to happen? We are then in danger to receive the mark thereof. Let there be clear that the beast mentioned by the third angel is the one that John saw, as he reported in the 10 first verses of the 13th chapter of Revelation. And let's turn in this chapter and let's read the 10 first verses of this chapter. And I stood upon the sand of the sea and saw a beast rise up out of the sea, having seven heads and ten horns, and upon his horns ten crowns, and upon his head the name of blasphemy. And the beast which I saw was like unto a leopard, and his feet were as the feet of a bear, and his mouth as the mouth of a lion. And the dragon gave him his power and his seat and great authority. And I saw one of his heads as it were wounded to death, and his deadly wound was healed. And all the world wandered after the beast, and they worshipped the dragon, which gave power unto the beast, and they worshipped the beast, saying, Who is like unto the beast? Who is able to make war with him? And there was given unto him a mouth speaking great things and blasphemies, and power was given unto him to continue 42 months. And he opened his mouth in blasphemy against God, to blaspheme his name and his tabernacle and them that dwell in heaven. And it was given unto him to make war with the saints, and to overcome them. And power was given him over all kindreds and tongues and nations, and all that dwell upon the earth shall worship him, whose name was not written in the book of life of the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. If any man have an ear, let him hear. He that leadeth into captivity shall go into captivity. He that killeth with the sword must be killed with the sword. Here is the patience and the faith of the saints. With the prophetic studies that we made in order to identify the mother of harlots, we can clearly see, my friends, that this beast presents the same characteristics than the beast of Daniel 7, but also than the little horn of the book of Daniel. And indeed, it raised up out of the sea like all the four beasts of Daniel 7, verse 2 and 3. Its body of leopard, its feet of bear, and its face of lion show that it is a combination of the first three beasts of Daniel 7. Like the little horn, its seat or place is the one of another. And like the little horn, it has a mouth speaking great things against God and blasphemies. And like the little horn, it makes war against the saints. And thus, during 42 months, which is a time and times and the dividing of time, or the 12 and 60 years given to the little horn. And also, after its reign of 1260 years, the investigative judgment must take place. So, when you have all of this parallel that you can make between what we saw in Daniel and that we just see here in Revelation 13, is it so difficult to conclude that this beast is the papal worm which receives the deadly wound when the French General Berthier brought Pope Pius VI in captivity in 1798? Is it so difficult with all of these things to conclude that? No. It's easy to do that. Yet, some so-called Bible-based Christians arrive to a different conclusion than this. Indeed, while they recognize that the mother of harlots is the Roman Catholic Church, while they recognize that the little horn of Daniel 7 is the papal Rome, and while they recognize that the papal worm is one of the head of the beast of Revelation 13, they teach that this beast is the European Union. This is the new teachings, friends. Some preachers, ministers, call them as you want. Some men, important men in our movement, in the Godhead movement, known, well known, start to teach that the beast is the European Union. And some of their arguments are that a horn always represents a kingdom, and a beast always represents an empire. So keep, catch that in your mind. They said that a horn always represents a kingdom, and a beast always represents an empire. Second point, that the papal Rome cannot be the beast because the mother of harlots, the Roman Catholic Church, is riding the beast. And second point, second reason why the papal Rome cannot be the beast, it's because the beast then will attack the harlots. Okay. And the third point is that the dragon of Revelation 13 cannot represent the Roman Empire, but only Satan. This is the main three arguments of this new movement. This is the main argument of these new people, these new prophetic people. But I have to be bold here, my friends, and say that this is not a Bible-based interpretation at all. Because when explaining the vision given to Daniel in Daniel 8, and let's go to Daniel chapter 8. And I, please, let's have our Bible, because we need to be sure that our interpretation is a Bible-based one. Amen. Let's go to Daniel chapter 8. My friends, I don't want any one of you take the mark of the beast. And that's why we need to know who is the beast. My friend, the third angel message is the last message of mercy to this world. My friend, I don't want any one of you take the mark of the beast. Let's go to Daniel chapter 8. Daniel chapter 8. And let's read in verse 21. Because when explaining the vision given to Daniel in chapter 8, Gabriel says that in verse 21, and the wrath God is the king of Grecia, and the great horn that is between his eyes is the first king. What is their argument? The argument is that, if I retake it for you, a horn always represents a kingdom, and a beast always represents an empire. This is their argument. But let's read again. What is the interpretation that Daniel received from Gabriel? Gabriel says to Daniel that the wrath God is the king. So the beast, the angel, Gabriel said that the beast is a king. Okay. And that beast, the goat, is the king of Grecia. Okay? And then he said that the horn is the first king. So the great horn of that beast is the first king. Am I correct? Are we correct? Are we okay here? Okay. It is clear, my friend, that a king is the head of a kingdom, right? Okay. And that an emperor is the head of an empire. But the argument that a horn must, let me repeat that for you. The argument that a horn must represent a kingdom and that a beast must represent an empire is in total contradiction to the teaching of Gabriel given to Daniel. Because here it is clear that the horn represented the first king and that the beast represented the kingdom. And this horn was Alexander the Great. And he was at the head of that kingdom at that moment when the long horn, the great horn, was at the front of the on the forehead of the beast. And that verse is completely ignored by them in their when they establish it, this rule of interpretation. Second point, and I want you, if someone here is sleepy, it's time to raise up. Nobody here must sleep, my friend. If you are sleepy, stand up. Drink little water because the matter is too important, my friend. The matter is too important, my friend. Let me refresh your mind and give you the situation. The third angel message is the first message of mercy for the world. The last message of mercy for this world. And this message, God sent this message that to prepare a people that they may have the seal of God and to prevent them to receive the mark of the beast. Friends, our salvation is at stake here. The second point, and I have a question for you in order to introduce that second point. Who is Christ for the church? The head. Is everybody okay with that? Amen.
Amen.
Nobody must. Why? What did I fear to say amen? Amen?
Amen.
Amen, yes, because Ephesians 5, verse 33, Colossians 1, verse 19 says, this verse says that Christ is the head of the church. He is the head of his church, and he's, Christ is the head of his church, and his church is his body. Yet, some believers have decided long time ago to give that position of head to a man bearing the title of Pope, which resulted in a dead body or a fallen church. And thus, though being its head, the Pope or the papacy is not the body of that fallen church named the Mother of Harlots. Did you understand that? Oh, I hope so. Let me repeat that for you. Some believer, long time ago, they decided to give the position of head to a man. And this man took the position of Christ for that group of people. So in that situation, we do not have a living body, but we have a dead body or a fallen church. And in that situation, who is the head of that fallen church? A man, a system named the papacy. But that man, that system, is not the body. He is the head of that body. And I made a nuance here. The thing that I just said is a nuance. And I will give you something that you can put beside this. Nuance. Nuance. Is it okay for everyone?
Yes.
Nuance. Sorry for my accent. I come from France. And my country give the deadly wound. This was a nuance, friends. This was a nuance. Sorry, I did not want to make any joke. The matter is too serious, friends. Father in heaven, I ask you your Holy Spirit, and I ask you discernment. And I don't want any here be moved by emotion, but by reason and enlightened by your Holy Spirit. In the name of Jesus, amen. That was a nuance, right, here, that I just made. But even if we look at them, that is the head, the papacy, and the body, the dead body, the Roman Catholic Church, even if we look at them as a unit, friend, even if we look at them as a unit, remember that one thing can be represented by two different symbols. And that's what we just read in Daniel 8, verse 21. Because the beast, the horn was Alexander the Great, and he was at the head of the beast, the goat. Now, concerning the attack of the war, let us consider what the Bible really says in Revelation chapter 17, verse 16. So that was my last point. Because they say that, you know, the beast, the woman is riding the beast, and it cannot be the beast. But we saw that Alexander was represented at the head of the beast. But what was the beast? What was the goat?
The beast.
The Empire of Grecia. And Alexander was a part of that power. But yet, God represented him as a horn. So God gave two different symbols, my friends. That is important. And now let us go to Revelation chapter 17, verse 16. And let us read that. Revelation 17, verse 16. Because here, and the 10 horns which thou sawest upon the beast, this shall hate the war, and shall make her desolate and naked, and shall heat her flesh, and burn her with fire. Concerning the attack of the war, the Bible says that the 10 horns. I invite you to follow with me in your Bible. Follow with me. The Bible says that the 10 horns shall hate the war and shall make her desolate and naked. I have a question for you. Who shall hate the war and shall make her desolate and naked? The 10 horns. Right. Amen. It's the 10 horns who will attack the war and not the beast. Am I right here? Yeah. Are we right here?
Yeah.
Let me repeat that for you. It's the 10 horns who will attack the war and not the beast, my friend. And not the beast through the 10 horns. I say this because the verse 17 is sometimes employed to say that the 10 horns give their kingdom unto the beast after. Let me repeat that for you. I say this because the verse 17 is sometimes employed to say that the horns give their kingdom unto the beast after their attack of the war. But, friends, this interpretation is wrong for at least two reasons. The first one is that in verse 18 of this chapter, let us read the verse 18 of this chapter. And the woman which thou sawest in that great city, which reigneth over the kings of the earth. The angel speak of the war who was killed in the verse 16. What would not be consistent if verse 16, 17, and 18 were in chronological order? This is the first point. And the second point, friends, these 10 horns are the divided kingdom which succeeded to Rome in Daniel 2 and 7, right? Okay. And interestingly, we know that these 10 kings of this kingdom hallowed to the papacy to start his reign of 12 and 60 years in 538 AD. What shows us that the captivity of the Pope in 1798 was the taking away of his domination mentioned in Daniel 7, verse 26, which is a partial fulfillment of the verse 17 of Revelation 17. No problem. Now, the third point of the main point, because there be subsection concerning the dragon. It is true that the dragon is a symbol of Satan, according to what we read in Revelation 12 and 9. And nobody can deny this because it is written in the Bible. But if we exclusively apply the symbol of the dragon to Satan, we should then understand that the woman in Revelation 12 is not the Church of Christ, but Mary. Yeah. Yet, the Bible does not tell us that. The Bible does not tell us that. The Bible does not tell us that before the birth of Jesus, Mary went on the moon and take the sun as a cloth. And, friends, I don't think that Mary, the servant of the Lord that God the Father used to accomplish the purpose for our salvation, I don't think that this woman lived on this earth from during 12 and 60 years, friend. That doesn't make sense. That doesn't make sense. To apply exclusively the dragon to Satan would lead us to this conclusion also. And that doesn't make sense, friends. But that the dragon of Revelation is also the symbol of the power brought to view in Daniel. That is, the first phase of the little horn, the pagan room, is evident from the fact that in both of these books, that is, Daniel and Revelation, in both of these books, it cast down stars to the ground. Did you remember this? Okay. It cast down stars to the ground. Daniel 8 verse 10 and Revelation 12 verse 4. And second point, it was before, that power was before the papal Rome. But a correct understanding of the heads and the horns of the beast would have prevented to these people to discard the papacy. Indeed, in Revelation 17, the angel said to John, and let's read verse 9 to 12. Revelation 17, verse 9 to 12. And here is the mind which hath wisdom. The seven heads are seven mountains on which the woman sitteth. And there are seven kings. Five are fallen, and one is, and the other is not yet come. And when he cometh, he must continue a short space. And the beast that was, and is not, even he is the eighth, and he is of the seven, and goeth into perdition. And the ten horns which thou sawest are ten kings, which are received no kingdom as yet, but receive power as kings 1 hour with the beast. Friends, according to the angel's description, the seven heads or the seven kings are not contemporaneous. Is it clear for you that word?
Contemporaneous.
Sorry for my accent. These ten kings are not contemporaneous. According to the reading of the Bible, these seven kings or seven heads are not contemporaneous, friends. Which is not the case with the horns, because they receive power with the beast. The Bible says that 1 hour or one at the same moment, okay? All of them receive power as king 1 hour or instant or season. We can translate that word with the beast. Now we know that these ten kings are the ten portrayed in Daniel 2 and 7, right? And these are the divided kingdom who succeeded to the Roman Empire. In other words, to Europe. But I have a question for you. If Europe is a beast, how can Europe receive power 1 hour with Europe? Because according to this teacher, the beast is the European Union. But how can Europe receive power 1 hour with Europe, friends?
Do they turn
interpreting horns as something other than Europe? How do they interpret the horns?
Seriously, I did not verify that point. I have to say
maybe
this.
They have a different view on that.
Maybe. But the when you have a close study, it seems to me that they recognize that the 10 horns are Europe. It seems to be. Maybe it's a mistake, but I. The evidence is there, my friend. The evidence is there. How can Europe shall give its power and its strength to Europe? That does not make sense, especially as Europe is not the head. Europe is not the head, which was wounded by a captivity after a reign of 1260 years where it made war with the saints as the papacy did. Secondly, the prophecies of the book of Daniel, especially Daniel 7 and 8, do not present Europe as being the final power of the controversy, as they did for the papacy. How many of you have an understanding that Revelation was, the book of Revelation was given to, complete and amplify what was written in Daniel? Yes. This is evident, friends.
Absolutely.
So, how God can, in Revelation, introduce something totally new, which was not brought to view in Daniel? That doesn't make sense. That doesn't make sense. And with all these things, friends, with all of this consideration, we have shown that a horn, the rule, the new rule, that a horn always represents a kingdom and a beast always represents an empire, is not a rule given by God. And that the papal Rome cannot be the beast because the mother of harlot, the Roman Catholic Church, is riding the beast. And that the beast then we'll attack her. We have found that, you know, this point is wrong because they have a wrong reading of the Bible. Because the Bible does not say Revelation 17, and we have proved this. Revelation 17 does not say that the beasts will eat. He said the kings, and remember that the kings are contemporaneous, which is not the case with the seven head. Friends, and third, the dragon of Revelation, the fact that according to them, the dragon of Revelation cannot represent the Roman Empire, but only Satan, we have shown that it's not correct. So, let us continue, but now with the image of the beast. The image of the beast is made by the inhabitant of the earth under the commandment of another beast described as follow in Revelation 13, verse 11 and 12. Revelation 13, verse 11 and 12. And I beheld another beast coming up out of the earth, and he had two horns like a lamb. And he spake as a dragon, and he exercised all the power of the first beast before him, and caused the earth and them which dwell therein to worship the first beast, whose deadly wound was healed. When John beheld it, this two-horned beast was coming up out the earth. That is from a new and previously unoccupied territory. Because water, the contrary of earth, means inhabited area. And you can check that interpretation in Revelation 17, verse 15. Which implies that it's coming up was peacefully. Second point, it arose about the time when the head of the bee, the first beast, was wounded. In which year? 1798. Here it has two horns like a lamb without crown on them, which means that it is not a monarchy, but something like a young republic inspired by Christianity and guided by two principles. Sorry. The only power which met all this condition is your country.
That's right.
The United States of America. And my country gave the deadly wound, but your country will do the opposite. And according to the Bible, this country, the United States of America, this country will change in order to speak, according to verse 11 and 12, as a dragon, and he will exercise all the power of the first beast before him and cause the earth and them which dwelt therein to worship the first beast whose deadly wound was healed. That change of manner of speaking and of exercise the power foretold that it will finally have laws contrary to the religious liberty as under the domination of the dragon, the pagan Rome, and the beast, the papal Rome. And moreover, the Bible says in verse 13 and 34 of Revelation 13, and he doeth great wonders so that he may fire come down from heaven and the earth and he doeth great wonders so that he make fire come down from heaven on the earth in the sight of men and deceive them that dwell on the earth by the means of those miracles which he had power to do in the sight of the beast, saying to them that dwell on the earth that they should make an image to the beast which had the wound, which had the wound by a sword and did live. Your nation will lead its own people to make an image to the beast. In other words, it will carry out decision under the influence of the church. And what kind of decision, friends? Let us read verse 15 and 17 of Revelation 13. And he had power to give life unto the image of the beast, that the image of the beast should both speak and cause that as many as would not worship the image of the beast should be killed. And he caused all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and bond, to receive a mark in their right hand or in their foreheads. Okay, and 17, and that no man might buy and sell save he that had the mark or the name of the beast or the number of his name. And I will stop there. Friends, as for Rome, the religious authority of the United States of America will use the civil power to control the conscience of the people in enforcing a law which will pay homage to the beast. And those who will not worship the beast and his image in obeying to this law will receive the mark of the beast. Those who teach that the beast is the EU, the European Union, also teach that the mark of the beast is homosexuality, as a result of the acceptance of evolution, humanism, and atheism. But, again, I have to say that such a conclusion is a mistake. Indeed, remember that the first angel requires the true worship, right? And while the third angel presents the true worship in contrast with a false one. And that is important, friends. And that's why at the beginning of this presentation, I said unto you that when God organized a camp meeting in his word, the messenger are in agreement. The first speakers teach something that will help the second speakers. And the second speakers, and the first also, the third speaker will be able to use the two previous message to give his message, friends. And according to the third angel, the true worship is based on what? Amen. The true worship, according to the third angel, the true worship is based on the commandment of God. That's all? And the faith of Jesus. Amen, my brother. The true worship is based on the commandment of God and the faith of Jesus, while the false worship is based on the entities and on what those these entities will do. And these entities are the beast and his image. And since the image of the beast is a counterfeit of the faith of Jesus, and who is Jesus?
Son of God.
Yeah. But else. Yes, but else. How many of you have read my article on the faith of Jesus that Smyrna Gospel Ministry published in November and September? Yes, but another thing. Jesus is the image of God. Yay! And God through the third angel, he put in contrast the beast and his image with God and his image, friend. Let me make a break here. The fallen church will not tell you that, friend. The Trinitarian church will not tell you that, friend. And that is so plain. That is so plain. And since the image of the beast is a counterfeit of the faith of Jesus, who is the image of God, then the mark of the beast must be a counterfeit of something that pertains to the commandment of God. And interestingly, my friends, those who are mentioned in Revelation 14, verse 12, are those who receive the seal of God, according to Revelation 7, and from verse 2 to 5, and Revelation 14, verse 1. Did you catch that point? Okay. And since the third angel started to give his message when Jesus came before the Ark of the Covenant in heaven, ark in which there is, among other things, the Ten Commandments of God, the Decalogue, it is clear that the commandment of God mentioned by the third angel is the Decalogue, the Ten Commandments. But which part of the law is concerned by the seal of God, my friend? In order to answer to this question, we need to know what is a seal. And according to Noah Webster's, we read that a piece of metal or other hard substance, usually round or oval, I guess, on which is engraved some image or device and sometimes a legend of or inscription. This is used by individuals, corporate bodies, or states for making impressions on wax upon instruments of writing as an evidence of their authenticity. Okay, and the last sentence, authenticity. Sorry, the King of England, and this is an example, has his seal and his privy seal. Seals are sometimes worn in rings. This is the definition of a seal. And we need to know now the composition of a seal. An official seal always indicates three things, my friend. And these three things are the characteristics of an official seal. The name of the legislator, for example, Donald Trump. His rank. What is his rank? President. And his realm. United States of America. So, which of the Ten Commandments contains all these characteristics, my friends? The Fourth Commandment. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days shalt thou labor and do all thy work. But the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord thy God. The name of the legislator, okay? In it thou shalt not do any work, thou, nor thy son, nor thy daughter, thy manservants, nor thy maidservants, nor thy cattle, nor thy stranger that is within thy gates. For in 6 day the Lord made, that is, if he made, it is the creator, so his rank, heaven and earth, the sea and all that is there, all that in them, and that portion is his realm. He is and rested the seventh day, wherefore the Lord blessed the seventh day Sabbath and hallowed it. And that's why we read in Exodus chapter 31 and verse 13. Exodus chapter 31, verse 13. Exodus chapter 31, verse 13. Exodus chapter 31, verse 13. Speak thou also unto the children of Israel, saying, verily, my Sabbath ye shall keep, for it is a sign between me and you throughout your generations, that ye may know that I am the Lord that doth sanctify you. It is a sign. The sign. And it's also to the sign or seal of God that the first angel's message that direct the attention. And I saw another angel flying in the midst of heaven, having the everlasting gospel to preach unto them that dwell on the earth, and to every nation and kindred and tongue and people, saying with a loud voice, fear God. And here we understand that it is mentioned of the Father of God, so we put the legislator, which is the name, and give glory to him, for the hour of the judgment, of his judgment, is come, and worship him that made, creator, this is his rank, even in earth and the sea and the fountains of water, is real. When God organized a camp meeting, my friends, the speakers are in agreement.
That's right.
Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. This is the pattern, Brother Helvis. This is the pattern of camp meeting, right? The pattern. We must follow that pattern, friends. It is thus obvious that the sign or seal of God is expressed in the fourth commandment. So consequently, the Sabbath instituted by the beast, the Sabbath of the first day, is the opposite of the seal of God. And thus, those who will continue to break the Ten Commandments, the expression of God's will, and especially the fourth commandment, will pay allegiance to the beast, the papacy, and these people, my friend, will receive the mark thereof. Now, I want to make a point before passing to another item, When God organized a camp meeting, the speakers of the camp meeting of God are in agreement, right?
Amen.
Amen. This is a pattern. So, nowadays we have preachers who are teaching feast days to keep the feast. And I was grateful to our brother, our dearest brother, whose name is, don't tell me I will, Lewis, Pastor L.T. Lewis. I was thankful for the message that he gave. Because, you know, the Ten Commandments here, as we saw, the commandment of God mentioned in Revelation 14, verse 12, is the Ten Commandment of God, friends. And it's not anything like feast day, feast keeping. And you have some people who take Malachi. Malachi verse chapter 4, let us with Malachi. And Malachi, last book, as Shemaiah told us. Malachi chapter 4 and verse 4. Remember ye the law of Moses, my servant, which I commanded unto him in Horeb for all Israel, with the statutes and the judgments. And friends, when you compare this reading to Deuteronomy chapter 4, and I invite you to write this reference, Deuteronomy chapter 4, verse 10 to 14. Deuteronomy chapter 4, verse 10 to 14. Deuteronomy chapter 4, verse 10 to 14. When you compare this verse to Deuteronomy chapter 4, verse 10 to 14, it is clear that the law to which it is mentioned, first of all, is the law of God. And some people take the statutes and the judgment to say that, you see, we must keep the feast because the feasts are contained in that. Pastor Allen will correct me if I'm wrong, but friends, here, he said, remember at that moment, and at which moment we are here in the day of the judgment, remember the law and the statute. But why? Because of what we saw this morning. Because God led our pioneers to have an understanding of the feast, to understand which feast was in the past and which was to be accomplished, that is the Day of Atonement, friend. Okay. So when the feasts which are fulfilled, my friend, do we need to keep the feast?
No.
Okay, amen. Let's return to Revelation 14 now. Revelation 14. And it is mentioned the wrath of God. I don't know if I put it here. We are also a theory. It's correct? My pronunciation is correct? A theory, okay. And some of these preachers of feast keepers are teaching that God does not kill. Let us read the third angel. I'm not here to give fear to anybody. You know, I'm not a preacher who want to inspire fear, but we need to have a right conception of God, my friends. Are we an intelligent people? Yeah. Yeah. Let us read the third angel. The verse 10. The same shall drink of the wine of the wrath of God, which is poured out without mixture into the cup of his indignation. And he shall be tormented with fire and brimstone in the presence of the holy angel and the presence of the Lamb. And it continues in verse 11. But friends, here it is evidence that the angel is speaking about the plagues. It is right, the plagues. So these people are removing some interpretation of the Bible just to say that God does not kill. And, you know, but God is a God of righteousness, friends. And sometimes God has to do the cleaning. I don't know if my word is correct, but the cleaning must happen. As I said, Smyrna Gospel Ministry has published 4 of my articles of the faith of Jesus, because here we are in the section of the faith of Jesus. So I will not be too long on that point. I recommend you to read that articles, if it's not already done. And I want to finish that prophetic study, and just open a little part of medical missionary work. We'll see now that how the medical missionary work is involved in the angel of revelation. Some of you may have think that I was here just to talk about doctrine. But that will be not the case. But I wanted to establish the doctrine, friends. Because we must give the last message of mercy to this world. And the message that we must have to give must be a clear message. Otherwise, we are leading people to be lost. So I am closing this part and just open a little part. It will not be too long. How the medical missionary work, just a break, here is the article of November 2016 and December 2016. For those who want to know, in that articles, I give many the explanation that God gave me concerning the faith of Jesus. So I will not be too long. That will be too long to insist upon the faith of Jesus. But I want you to know something, my friend. As Adventists, as Seventh-day Adventists, we have largely insist upon the Ten Commandments. But the Ten Commandments are a part of the third angel message. The other part are the faith of Jesus, my friend. And let me tell you something. If we do not have the faith of Jesus, we will not be able to keep the commandment of God. So let us have our little study to see how the medical missionary work, how the health reform is involved in the message of revelation. In that presentations, we saw the fourth angel. The first angel, what is one of the one of the center of his message. To give, he asked to give glory to God. And when we read 1 Corinthians, and I know that many of the speakers here have presented that this statement, but let us read them. 1 Corinthians, chapter 6, verse 19 and 20. Okay? 1 Corinthians, chapter 6, verse 19 and 20. And what? Know ye not that your body is the temple of the Holy Ghost, which is in you, which ye have of God, and ye are not your own? For ye are bought with a price. Therefore, glorify God in your body and in your spirit, which are God's. So, we can clearly see here that the first angel message have an interest in the health reform, but also in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 31, a verse which must be well known here. 1 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 31. I will be quick. Whether therefore ye eat or drink or whatsoever ye do, do all to the glory of God. Amen. It's clear. Eating, drinking, all what we do, we must do it for the glory of God. And in doing that for our body, we are following the message of the first angel. Now, the second angel. What is the theme of his message? Babylon is fallen. But concerning the health, the wine of a fornication. So this message is preventing us against the intoxication. Do you know that sometimes we are eating things that bring intoxication in our body? And one of the means to remove this intoxication is exercise, right? And we have also things that we can take as drink or eating or to eat to remove the intoxication, friends. And as Di Mario said, it is true that it is spiritual, but what it is spiritual is an index of, I cannot remember what he's saying, is an index of what is
physical. That which we see on the outside is an index of what is inside.
Exactly. It's an index of what it is inside. So otherwise, if that was not the case, God will not use this symbol to teach us some things which are spiritual. Now, the third angel, what is his purpose concerning the health reform? The third angel, let us open our Bible in Matthew 4, verse 23. And those who have read my articles know which points I will introduce now. Matthew 4, verse 23. The third angel speaks about the faith of Jesus and the commandment of God and the faith of Jesus. Matthew 4, verse 23. And Jesus went about all Galilee, teaching in their synagogues and preaching the gospel of the kingdom and healing of all manner of sickness and all manner of disease among the people. When I read the verse in my Bible, the part of healing, the half of the verse. It occupied the half of the verse, friend. Look at in your Bible. The healing part occupied the half of the verse, friends. Preaching preaching, teaching is one part. And healing is the other part. And who is that man who was doing that on earth? It was Jesus. And the third angel direct our attention to the faith of Jesus. Hebrews 12, verse 2 says that, look at Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. Author means the captain, the chief, and finisher, the completer, the one who brings the faith to the level at which the faith must arrive, friends. So when we want to have the faith of Jesus, we must, friends, we should, not should, we must have an interest at least, an involvement, a certain degree of involvement in the health reform. Otherwise, we cannot follow the Lamb wherever to wherever he goeth. We must have that faith, friends. We must have that faith of Jesus. That faith which brings that faith this faith will be in construction in us, that faith, how can I say this? That faith will lead us to teach the people to obey the commandment of God in their body. As in the spiritual level, we will do that on the physical level. Now, in Revelation 18, what is the purpose of the message? And now, open your Bible, please, with me, because that is really important, friend. Revelation 18. And before we read this few verses, and just after that, I will finish. It will be finished, my presentation. Remember what we said at the beginning of this presentation, that once we accept the first message, we are in condition to accept the second message. And once we accept the second message, we are in condition to accept the third message. Okay? And once we accept the third message, we are in condition to accept the fourth message. Now, let's read the fourth message. Let us begin in verse 1. And after these things, I saw another angel come down from heaven, having great power, and the earth was lightened with his glory. And he cried mightily with a strong voice, saying, what? Babylon the Great is fallen, and is become the habitation of devils, and a hall of every foul spirit, and a cage of every unclean and hateful bird. For all nations have drunk of the wine of the wrath of her fornication, and the kings of the earth have committed fornication with her, and the merchants of the earth are waxed rich through the abundance of her delicacies. Here, we have the hand of this angel. And after that, we have another agent who pronounced to come out of her. And remember that the fourth angel, Once you accept the third angel, you are in condition to accept the fourth angel. But once you reject the third angel or any of the three previous angels, you are thus in condition to reject the fourth angel. And that's why the fourth angel repeats to the people that in the area of healing, of health reform, he repeats, he put again the emphasis on the drinking of wine, of intoxication. But you will tell me that maybe something is lacking here. And that's true, because when we consider the message given by the agents mentioned in verse 4, and when we go in verse 23, let us turn to verse 23 of Revelation 18. And the light of a candle shall shine no more at all in thee, and the voice of the bridegroom and of the bride shall be heard no more at all in thee. For thy merchants were the great men on the earth, for by thy sorceries were all nations deceived. By thy sorceries were all nations deceived. I wanted to mention something that, just a break. I wanted to mention something that Brother Mac remembered unto me last night. He told me that we can also sell all denomination concerning the spiritual level. Okay. Now, concerning the elf level. Thy sorceries were all nation deceived. What is the point here? The word sorceries here is translated from the word pharmakia. And that word means, according to the Strong's dictionary, medication, pharmacy, by extension, magic, literally or figuratively, sorcery, witchcraft. And this word comes from the word pharmakios, and which have more which have also a significance close to the area of pharmacy, medication, drugs, and stuff like that. And you can check it if you have a strong concordance, pharmakios. I will not be too long on that point, but when I came to that knowledge, I said to myself, I started to ask me question, why the store where we should buy our remedies, why its name is pharmacy? Why the name of the store where we should buy our medication, why its name is pharmacy? And I want to leave you with that question. Because as Brother Andy said, and even Brother DiMario and all the speakers, we cannot enter into detail right now. But brothers and sisters, why? And God says that all nation was deceived by the pharmakia, by the pharmacy, by the drugs, and stuff like that. All nation. During all of this, and this is my last point. Yeah. During all of this presentation, I was mainly focused on the Bible, because we are accused to not be Christian, Bible-based Christian friends. But I must tell the following. I have a huge confidence in the spirit of prophecy manifested in the gift of Ellen G. White. Amen. And when I read, maybe it's the ministry of healing, she said that the world is like the house of Lazarus. The world. And when I read the Bible, all nation was deceived by that. Let's have a word of prayer, friend.
Our Father in heaven, thank you so much for this blessing that you've given to us to open your Bible and to study and to see the evidence that you place for us in your Bible. Father, you want us to be with you in your heavenly kingdom, and that's why you sent message for us to that we may be fit for heaven. So, Father, we ask you to continue the good work that you started in us and the work that you want also work out here through us, carry out through us. And that's why I ask you to be with us and to, in order that we as people, we should not be deceived by any winds of doctrine and by any false conception of the elf reform, and because the nation is deceived and we should not be among them. So Father, thank you so much for all this light, all this light that you've given to us, more light that the previous people did not have. Thank you so much, Father. Thank you for this love, because when you show us things, it's because you love us and you want to see us abide in light. Thank you so much, dear Father. And we pray thee in the name of Jesus Christ. Amen.